Assalamualaikum Sobat Juru Kunci Masjid. Mohon dimengerti bahwa menurut aturan YouTube terbaru sekarang, bahwa video asli yang akan kami terjemahkan ini harus disertai komentar atau tanggapan. Tanpa adanya komentar atau tanggapan, maka kami akan dikenakan sanksi oleh YouTube. Memang berat rasanya, tapi kami harus mentaati aturan ini. Namun jika Anda kurang berkenan komentar dari kami, silahkan Anda percepat videonya untuk langsung masuk ke video aslinya yang sudah kami terjemahkan. Berbicara tentang hidayah berarti membahas perkara yang paling penting dan kebutuhan yang paling besar dalam kehidupan manusia. Betapa tidak, hidayah adalah sebab utama keselamatan dan kebaikan hidup manusia di dunia dan akhirat. Sehingga barang siapa yang dimudahkan oleh Allah Ta'ala untuk meraihnya, maka sungguh dia telah meraih keberuntungan yang besar dan tidak akan ada seorang pun yang mampu mencelakakannya. Hidayah yang didapatkan seseorang dapat menuntunnya ke jalan yang benar. Hidayah adalah terbukanya hati untuk menerima Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala dan lapangnya dada untuk meyakini kebenaran agama Islam. Dalam surah Al-An'am ayat 125, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala berfirman, "Barang siapa yang Allah menghendaki akan memberikan kepadanya petunjuk. Niscaya dia melapangkan dadanya untuk memeluk agama Islam." Hidayah menjadi salah satu petunjuk Allah yang diberikan kepada hambanya, sehingga terbuka menerima Islam. Allah berfirman, "Maka apakah orang-orang yang dibukakan Allah hatinya untuk menerima agama Islam, lalu ia mendapat cahaya dari Tuhannya, sama dengan orang yang membatu hatinya? Maka kecelakaan yang besarlah bagi mereka yang telah membatu hatinya untuk mengingat Allah, mereka itu dalam kesesatan yang nyata." Az-Zumar 22. Hidayah tidak dapat dibeli, tapi ini adalah nikmat Allah yang hanya dianugerahkan kepada hambanya yang dikehendakinya. Seperti firman Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala berikut ini, "Sesungguhnya kamu tidak akan dapat memberi petunjuk kepada orang yang kamu kasihi, tetapi Allah memberi petunjuk kepada orang yang dikehendakinya. Dan Allah lebih mengetahui orang-orang yang mau menerima petunjuk." Al-Qasas 56. Hal itulah yang dialami oleh Anthony Green. Pria yang kini menjadi seorang pendakwah ini punya sejarah panjang bagaimana ia sampai memeluk Islam. Nama aslinya Anthony Fastwaff Galvin Green. Ia telah berganti nama ketika memutuskan memeluk Islam. Terlahir di Dar As-Salaam, Tanzania, Green adalah seanak seorang pejabat kolonial Inggris. Saat masih kecil, Green dimasukkan ke sekolah agama di Bologna. Setelah lulus, Green kembali belajar agama di sekolah agama di Yorkshire, Inggris Utara. Tetapi dalam diri Green sering timbul pertanyaan mengenai konsep ajaran yang dianut oleh ibunya. Dia juga merasa aneh dengan doktrin pengakuan dosa. Menurutnya itu adalah doktrin aneh dan tidak lebih dari konspirasi besar untuk mengendalikan orang lain. Anda penasaran mendengarkan kisahnya? Nah, silakan Anda lihat videonya yang sudah kami terjemahkan berikut ini.
I was born in 1964, Anthony Wacław Gavin Green. My mum is Polish and my dad is British, and I was born in Tanzania because my dad was a colonial administrator there. When I was 2 years old, we left to come back to England, and my dad started working for Barclays International. When I was 10 years old, we moved out to Egypt. In the meantime, I went to boarding school. Initially a prep school called Gillingham Castle, and then onto the famous, well-known Roman Catholic monastic boarding school, Ampleforth College. My mum had signed me up for that place even before I was born. I didn't really enjoy boarding school at all, and I think that had a very big impact on me questioning the doctrines of the Catholic Church that I was brought up into. In fact, I remember that even before I was going to school, my mum thought she should teach me the Catholic prayer, the Hail Mary. And as it goes, Hail Mary, Mother of God, blessed art thou amongst women, I started thinking, Mother of God, how can God have a mother? And those are the first questions I started asking about the religion that I was brought up into. My questioning didn't end. In fact, it continued as I, throughout my teenage years, began to really question what was the purpose of life, why was I here? Particularly, I used to think, why am I here in this school? Why am I here in this monastic boarding school? I really didn't enjoy it, and I couldn't figure out really what was the purpose of it, except that I was supposed to work hard, get good exam results, so I could go to a good university, so I could get a good job, so I could make enough money to send my kids back to the same school, so that they could work hard and get good exam results, so they could go to a good university, so that they could make enough money to send their kids back to the same school. And I just figured, this can't be the purpose of life. There's got to be something more to life than this. So combining that with the sort of dissatisfaction I had of the doctrines of Roman Catholicism, I began to question a lot of things. Another thing that really got me thinking was the contrast between the mentality and the culture of people in England and the mentality and the culture of people in Egypt, which was, for all intents and purposes, my new home. And once I'd got used to life in Egypt and began to observe people, I began to realize that it was amazing how they were very, very content with very, very little in their life. Nothing really seemed to get them down. They seemed to be really happy, full of life, and everything was inshallah, if God wills it, ma'alesh, it's okay, alhamdulillah, all praises due to Allah. It's something that really, really struck me. How come the people in the West who have all the materialistic benefits seem to be so unhappy? I used to sometimes think of it as the land of the living dead. Yet there it was in Egypt where people, most of the people had so little, yet they were so happy. It went against everything I had been taught. The equation that wealth and money equals happiness. I was seeing a different viewpoint of reality. It made me profoundly question the paradigms that I was brought up into. In the 10 years I spent in Egypt, only two people really talked to me about Islam, and only one of them was a conversation that had any real impact on me. I was working on a tugboat servicing oil rigs in the Red Sea for about 6 weeks, and the vice captain of the boat came down and decided to have a conversation with me about religion. And so he started asking me, questioning me about my beliefs. And although I, at that time, was already having serious doubts about Christianity. In fact, I had been sort of practicing a form of Buddhism for a couple of years and was reading and studying around many, many different religions. But at the end of the day, when people ask me, I still call myself a Christian. And so I started trying to explain to him the theology of the Trinity, the idea that there was one God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, but they were not three gods, but they were one God. And how the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost were different, but yet they were all the same. And of course, he found this incomprehensible, because it is in fact incomprehensible. And at the end of this conversation, he said to me, okay, so you believe that Jesus is God? I said, yes. And he said, and you believe that Jesus died on the cross? I said, yes. Then he said, so you believe that God died? And when he asked me that question, it had a very, very huge impact on me. It really made me profoundly question for the first time everything I believed. In fact, in reality, he clarified for me, he added up all the things that in my head already did not make sense. And he really, in a very simple formula, made it clear in my mind why the doctrine of Christianity was really something I couldn't believe in. So after looking and experimenting and with so many different religions and philosophies and ideas and different ways of thinking, I actually came to the stage when I had made my own religion for myself, which was a sort of mixture of, you know, all the different things I've been reading about and studying. And so I had my own religion, which is actually really the worst thing of all. It was so terrible that actually I just actually at that stage gave up, and I thought maybe there is no meaning to life, deeper meaning to life. Maybe really all there is to life is just getting wealthy and having a good time. Maybe I didn't have enough money. Maybe I needed some more money. And so I started thinking, well, you know, if the formula really is wealth equals happiness, obviously you don't want to have to work too hard for that wealth, because you want to be able to enjoy all the things in life to the maximum. So what I really need is a lot of wealth with very, very little money. How do I get lots of money with very little work? So I started thinking about that. And I started thinking about civilizations, people, societies who had lots of money. And all of them, whether it was the British, the Industrial Revolution, the American Dream, the Japanese, it's all around hard work, until suddenly it popped into my head, wait a minute, Saudi Arabia. They got lots of money, and they haven't done any work, sitting on their camels going, Allahu Akbar. And, you know, I thought that sounds like a formula for success. So I started thinking, okay, so Saudi Arabia, Islam, Quran. I know, yeah, I know the Quran. I know that's their book. I know a bit about Islam. I don't know much, but I know something. So anyway, I went down to W.H. Smith's and I picked off the bookshelf the Penguin Classics series, the Quran, which is apparently one of the worst translations anyway, but it just goes to show. And I started to read it. And when I started to read it, I realized this was not like any other book I had ever read. First of all, it was a very difficult book to read. The Quran is not an easy book to read. You have to really want to get through it. And I did. I didn't just want to read it. I wanted to understand what the message of this book was. How did this message so profoundly affect those people? And so it forced me to think, and think very, very deeply. In fact, it's interesting that the Quran invites you to think. It keeps on saying, it keeps on inviting the person to look at the signs, look at the signs throughout the heavens and the earth, and think about them deeply and profoundly. And in these things are signs for those who are wise, those who have the ability to understand. So it's a book that itself invites you to think. And although I was and still am quite a fast reader, 2 weeks later, I was still reading this book. And I remember the moment very, very distinctly, as I was sitting on the train, going over the Thames, commuting on my way to work, reading this translation of the Quran. I looked out of the window and I looked back again, and I said to myself, if I have ever read a book that is from God, this is the one. And I think really, I guess that's the moment, that was my epiphany, that was the moment when in reality I embraced Islam. And my further studies, when I read a life history of the Prophet Muhammad, I was even more convinced. I was sure that this man was a prophet of God. In fact, the Quran says that those people, or the meaning of what the Quran tells us, is that the people of knowledge, of the Jews and the Christians, they know that Muhammad is a prophet like they know their own sons. Just as they know this is my son, they know that Muhammad is a prophet of God. And I am sure from my experience of a pretty thorough Christian education, reading, learning, studying the Bible, knowing the lives of prophets, knowing who and what prophets were, if anyone reads the Quran and reads the life of the Prophet Muhammad and they have that type of background knowledge, they will definitely know that Muhammad is a messenger of God. And if they deny it, I truly believe they are just lying. So alhamdulillah, that's really my story of how I came to Islam. I think the thing that profoundly affected me most about the Quran were two things. Number one, what the Quran says about God. The concept of God in the Quran is so clear, it's so reasonable, it makes so much sense. It's free of all the confusions that other religions have about God. It's really a God, the concept of God that one can really believe in. That's the first thing. And the second thing was the descriptions in the Quran of the Day of Judgment, of the paradise, of the hellfire. Rich, full descriptions of the afterlife. And that really impressed me, because I thought that, look, if there is a life after death, then surely God is going to tell us lots about it. And that's something that the Bible, for example, is pitifully short of, descriptions of what's going to happen after you die, whereas the Quran is full of them and rich detail. So those were the things that really impressed me about the Quran. The other thing was that the Quran, there didn't seem to be anything superfluous. Everything seemed to be important and to have meaning. And that was, again, to contrast with my experience of reading the Bible in particular, which had a load of stuff, long lists of names and details that just doesn't seem to have any relevance, any spiritual or real significant relevance. So these are the sort of things that really, really impressed me about the Quran. And when I read the life of the Prophet Muhammad, I mean, what can I say? If you wanted to write the life history of a person who fits the profile of a prophet, that was it. I mean, it was just, everything was there. His sincerity, his honesty, his kindness, his compassion, yet at the same time, his absolute firm conviction and dedication to obeying God and worshiping God and being uncompromising in that. When it came to matters of the religion, he did not compromise, but yet at the same time, he managed to be a very compassionate, merciful person. And also, it's that character of the Prophet Muhammad that makes it so believable, so possible, that he is truly what he claimed to be, a messenger from Allah. And what can I say? I thank Allah, I thank God that he guided me to Islam. Islam is so beautiful. Islam gives such peace and tranquility and happiness to your heart. I often think that I don't know what I did to deserve to be a Muslim. And I do hope that you explore this beautiful religion and that you're guided to this truth as well. And may the peace and blessings of God be upon you. Assalamu alaikum.
Begitulah pengalaman Abdul Rahim Green, pria Inggris yang menjemput hidayah Islam. Ternyata masuk Islamnya pria bermata hijau ini membawa barokah besar bagi umat Islam. Melalui organisasinya IERA yang didirikannya bersama rekan-rekannya, dia sudah mengislamkan ribuan orang dari berbagai dunia. Mereka masuk ke suku-suku terpencil di Afrika, Amerika Selatan hingga benua Asia untuk menyiarkan agama ini. Meski tidak jarang dia sering mendapatkan fitnah dan cobaan saat berdakwah. Saat ini hidupnya hanya untuk agama, berjuang menegakkan agama Allah di muka bumi. Semoga kita bisa mengambil hikmah dan manfaat dari kisah ini. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. God.